Come on, come on. Come on, come on. Come on, come on. Antifa.
I and I speak on behalf of U of R, SDS, Students for Democratic Society. We, along with Rochester Red and Black, helped bring these four comrades here to tell us about what's going on over in Greece, especially in regards to the rise of Golden Dawn and how people are resisting outside of traditional sort of state methods. So we're going to talk about that, and then probably after we hear from the three of them, open it up for some Q&A. And so yeah, also if you're interested, if you are a U of R student and you're interested in coming to SDS meetings, or if you're not a U of R student for that matter, SDS meets on Mondays at 9 o'clock in the Ruth Merrill Center, which is in Wilson Commons, which is our main student union. So feel free to come and stop by. And I think we're going to hear from the other co-sponsor, Jake, speaking on behalf of Red and Black.
Yeah. Hi, everyone. I'm Jake. I work with Rochester Red and Black. We're a local anarchist-communist organization dedicated to advancing anti-authoritarian ideas and practice here in Rochester. We've been organizing for about 2 years, and we're really excited to, as our latest event, bring some of our comrades from Greece here to talk about the struggles against fascism in their home country. So if anyone, I won't say too much more, I know you guys want to hear from them, so if anyone's interested in getting on our listserv, we have a pretty low traffic listserv. I'll pass around a little sign-in sheet, thank you all for coming.
Good evening, everyone. My name is Chris Spanos, and it's a pleasure to be here this evening in Rochester. We'd like to thank SDS and Rochester Red and Black once again for having us. Can everyone hear me? Okay. You hear me in the back over there? Okay, awesome. So, tonight's event is very exciting for us. It's, I think, our 8th or 9th stop, 8th or 9th event on a 21-event tour in the Northeast here. And so we're trying to bring a perspective that's not often portrayed in the media here. As you probably know, the mainstream media perspective presents us with a very narrow spectrum about what's occurring in Greece, a perspective that's defined by characteristics that focus on the Eurozone crisis generally, the economic crisis in Greece specifically, Syriza, the left opposition party, the main opposition party, as well as street clashes and Molotov cocktails and the rise of the neo-Nazi party Golden Dawn. For those who are not familiar with Golden Dawn, they won 18 seats out of a 300-seat parliament in the last elections, and they've recently tried to expand into North America with efforts to open up offices and chapters in New York, Montreal, and we've heard rumors of other places. So, with that said, it's a great opportunity and a special privilege to have here three participants in the street-level struggles of what's happening in Greece, in Athens. Street-level struggles that arrived at through an anti-authoritarian participation and way of organizing and trying to deal with the social and material crisis of their country. Thanasis Xirotsopanos here is a, to my immediate left, is a longtime participant in the anarchist community in Athens, the squat community of Greece. Sofia Papagiannaki is a participant in ecological struggles, including the struggle against gold mines in Greece, which was in the news today for a special brutal crackdown that you may have heard something about. And Vangelis Nanos at the far left of the table is has a history of the student movement and involvement in the student occupations of the island of Crete, as well as in Athens. All three of the participants participate in Alpha Kappa. Alpha Kappa is the English acronym for, the Greek acronym for the anti-authoritarian movement, which the translation doesn't translate so well. What's lost in the translation is that it actually broadly means the anti-authoritarian action. It doesn't. It's not an organization in the traditional sense, but it is a strongly bound network. They also participate in Nosotros, which is a free social center in Exarchia. Exarchia is a fountain of rebellion in the central district of the city of Athens, And Nosotros is one of many social spaces, free social spaces, that operate there. Nosotros is a hub for activities for a variety of different groups that participate and organize cultural, artistic, and political actions and events out of there. All three participate in the anti-fascist motorcycle patrols, which you may have heard about. There was one that had 300 bikes not that long ago, with two people per bike, with club-size sticks with red and black flags going through fascist strongholds, chanting anti-fascist slogans. There was another one not so long ago with 500 motorcycles, two people per bike. These are growing, and the street-level resistance is growing. They also participate in Entasi FM, a pirate radio station out of Athens. So, with that said, I will hand it over to Vangelis on the end of the table there to get us started. And then we'll go on for about 45 minutes to an hour and then have a discussion.
First of all, I would like to apologize for my English. I will try to read my text because I think it's better like this. So, first of all, I would like to thank you for the invitation. For us, this invitation is an opportunity to give our point of view about the social movements in Greece, the rise of the neo-Nazist party, and the conversation that's happening in the Greek society. It's also a challenge to inspire and inspired by you. So we will try our speeches to be as brief as possible because we think that the most important thing is to have a long conversation with you. So, the rising of Golden Dawn is a complex issue in which the state, the movement, crisis, the political parties, the tradition of the right-wing politics, and many more reasons that we will be try to analyze later on, had contributed on. But before we see some things about Golden Dawn, a small neo-Nazist gang which suddenly gained the power to determine the political agenda in Greece, I would like to speak a little bit about the political context in Greece before the fall of Junta and after the establishment of democracy. Junta is a dictatorship that we used to have in Greece until 1974, with Papadopoulos was the dictator. So, at 1929, Eleftherios Venizelos makes a law that says that everyone who is a communist or democratic must go to jail by name. This law is called the Ideonimum, and it's the beginning of a many-year story that we have in Greece with massive arrests and prosecutions. It was the year that for the first time the Communist Party of Greece has been illegal. So, 7 years after that, one day before the 24-hour general strike, which was organized by the leftists and the Democrats in 1936, Metaxas took the power by force. And we have a new one of the first dictatorships in Greece. So once again he makes special laws against communists, democrats and left people in general. Even if Metaxas had good relationships with both Hitler and Mussolini, Greece, because of it used to have a big movement even in that these days, participated in the war against fascism. During the German occupation in Greece, Greek right wing was German's right hand. On the other hand, communists and democrats created the National Liberty Forces, which was the main force of the Greek resistance this period. The right wing give information to Germans, they make mixed guerrilla groups with German against the LAS, and they were the police enforcement in the cities. After the liberation, right wing tried to take the power by sending to the exile Democrats and the communists, and torturing or killing thousands. in 1946 start what we call the second guerrilla, the Greek Civil War. Leftists, after many mistakes of their leaders, surrender, and once again they were sent to exile, killed or tortured by the next dictators and the king. In 1967, once again the power is taken by right wing. This time we had what we call a junta that that is for 7 years. In 1974, with the fall of junta, the constitution is changed and officially we have democracy. But still, the authority is in the right-wing hands. So, all these years, from 1929 to 1974, the people in Greece was left, or what was far left or far right wing, both of them in the name of the nation and the patriotism. This is something that still going on, happens in the Greek society. Even the leftists, they use very much the nation and the patriotism for the arguments. So what happened? The question is, what happened to all these people who supported the right-wing ideology, the junta, the dictatorship, and the Nazis in Greece? I believe that the answer is that after the fall of junta, they support the right-wing party of a new democracy. But they still keep their beliefs, and now they vote for Golden Dawn. Or they become policemen. You must know that 50% of the police votes for the Golden Dawn, and in some specific police forces the percent goes higher, maybe 90% or something like this. So the history of Greece is more or less something like that. Our grandfathers were killed or tortured by the right wing. Our grandfathers from the right wing in cooperation with the Nazis, our fathers by the right wing in the period of junta, and now for us it's the point that we have to decide. Either we stand with dignity and fight against the neo-Nazis, or we will be once again in the same position. So I would like to say some things about the crisis. The crisis is a crisis, and I will say some more historical things in a while. So, the crisis is a crisis of meaning, first of all. The major meanings which were created by and have created the imaginary of the Neo-Hellenes, it's what we use for the Greek, it's the same word, Hellenes and Greek. For the Neo-Hellenes, which is this imaginary, it's something like the man who owns, the guy who owns easy profit, mass prostitution, client relationships, glamour, macho, etc. Suddenly falling apart. The individual is standing alone and scared in front of a big apocalypse. It realized that his life is insignificant, as Castoriadis said. The individual has two options, either to return to the past by rebirthing the corpses of the ideologies, and this time as a farce, or to emerge a new collective individual which will include new meanings, a new imaginary, which will give him the opportunity to constitute a new life. Both of them do happen in the Greek society. For one hand, we have self-organized structures as the factory of Biome, the social free clinics, public houses, collective kitchens and other collectives, free social spaces, institutions of horizontal and solidarity economy. And on the other hand, we have people who go back to racism, nationalism, fascism, neo-Nazism, rebirthing the darkest pages of the political history. But the crisis is economical too. The giant middle class of Greece, which for more than 30 years generated the imaginary that I mentioned above, the Neo-Hellenes, in 3 years period, belittled so much that for most of the Greek families, it's very difficult to survive. You must know that we have unemployment raised to 26%. And if you add the people that are very young or too old to work, we have one out of five people to work. And the people who work, they take a basic salary, 500 euros, or maybe less. So the ex-middle class became unemployment class, understanding that whatever the capitalist system promised to them, it can make it happen. They have no secure, they have no prosperity, there is no equality. The state and the capitalism have lost their reliability. This creates a gap between authority and society. The first sign were during the revolt of December 2008, when a 15-year-old boy has been murdered by the police. Back then, they excluded, knowing that they had nothing to wait for by this system, they took by force what capitalism has promised to them and never gave it. Another thing is that we believe that there is no united subject who can be represented by the authority. In the past years, Greece has created subjects without subjectivity. I will call this non-subjectivity subjects mass individual. The common characteristics of this mass individual was easy to represent by the authority. After 2008 revolt, the 2010 Syntagma occupation and the movement for direct democracy, plus the economical and social transformation because of the crisis, the mass individual regained the subjectivity and was defined once again as individual, which no authority can represent it anymore because there is nothing united and common to the society to be represented. The gap between authority and society is getting bigger. In front of this crisis of representation, the state attempts to close the gap either by force or by adopting far-right political thesis. That gives in a way the social legalization to the extreme right wing to act or to ask the voters to assign them to clean the space, as they say in the slogans. On the other hand, the space between authority and society want to be claimed from the movement and from the conservatism too. So another important thing is how the lefts act before the rise of the Golden Dawn. So we have the immigration issue and how the leftists act about this. The movement in general and the leftists mostly, instead of trying to give a crucial proposition about the immigration issue, they left all the doors open to the extreme right wing by proposing humanitarianism as the unique argument. In a tough reality, that argument gave to the right wing the opportunity to spread their arguments of hate. They ask to deport a percent of the immigrants, they ask to deport all the immigrants, or as Golden Dawn wants, burn all the immigrants in ovens. There was an opportunity that had been betrayed. In the context I spoke above, in 2010, Syntagma occupation and the movement of direct democracy, it was a big opportunity for the movement to give massive social aspect to constructions that had been created there, and constitute more in the base of direct democracy, social autonomy and solidarity. But this opportunity was missed because of the upcoming elections. The leftists changed the subject of the talk with a very tricky question. We want or we don't want the IMF. And all the political talk start to be over this. We believe in this point that it was the opportunity for the society to leave authority and state and to have another path. But unfortunately, we go back to how which of the parties will represent us in the parliament. So, two main things are happening because of this. First, the leftists start a nationalist delirium about national traitors and the good of the nation. But the worst of all was that after that, the people lost their desire to constitute new structures, and once again they assigned the quest of the answers to the political issues of the everyday life to the specialist of the politics. People after this only had only to come one per week to their struggling duties. So I will. I'm coming back to the historical fact for a while. The final countdown for the Golden Dawn birth. At 1976, 16th of December 1976, we have Evangelos Malios' funeral. Evangelos Malios was a very well-known torturer in the period of Huda. So in his funeral, we have for the first time the Michaloliakos, which is the leader of Golden Dawn, to the main to the center political scene. Michaloliakos attacked some journalists who were there, and the police arrest him. After this, for 1 year, until 1977, Michaloliakos is involved in a nationalist guerrilla group. They stopped the actions about the same year, and then Michaloliakos started to prepare the Golden Dawn organization. In 1981, we have the first document of Golden Dawn, in which document they admit that their beliefs are similar with Metaxas and Papadopoulos, the two dictators that Greece had, and they admit also that they admire Adolf Hitler and the SS. Since 1981 until the elections of 2012, Golden Dawn was a small group, and they are very rarely participate in the central political scene. I think it was 1991 where they had massive immigration for Albania, so they did some actions against immigrants. We have in the same period some big demonstrations for the name of Macedonia. And at 1996, because of an episode between some Turkish journalists and some Greek and the Greek army, they have again one big demonstration, but they still have it. This demonstration, it's, I think, the biggest thing that they do. All these years, they attack to immigrants, leftists, LGBTQ people, leftist anarchists, but it's very rarely, and most of the times it's nothing important. We have, I think, only three times very heavy casualties. Unfortunately, nowadays we must admit that the 7% of the 60% of the voters, we have in Greece 40% upstanding, believe that Greek people have different blood and they have not to affect it with the blood of other nations. They believe, this 7% of the 60%, believe that we must attack Turkey to take over Istanbul, attack to Bulgaria, Albania. I'm not sure if they want to attack in Italy too. They believe that communists, anarchists, anti-authoritarians, Democrats, Jews, Muslims, Buddhists, colored people, gay, lesbians, trans, queer, people who need special care, immigrants, and some others must be extinguished so the Greeks can grow. With this in mind and the police encouragement, Golden Dawn has stamped over 10 people, most of the times very poor immigrants, they have been synagogues and mosques. They start an everyday pogrom against immigrants who work in open markets. They attack to gay bars. They go to the hospitals and ask from the doctors to throw out the immigrants. 99.9% of the doctors deny to do this, to be honest. They went to school and to schools and asked from the teachers to throw out the children without Greek blood. They punch a member of the Communist Party of Greece. They stop one theatric play as blasphemous. And last but not least, they admit first that their hands can make the Sieg Heil salute because they haven't stolen the state, and secondly, they admit that they only use the parliament so they can have guns licenses and not to be arrested when things go tough. So the question is, why these people? I will say what we are doing in Greece and what we have to do, but I have a question to, before this. Why these people are trying to open offices to the USA or Australia or in all the other countries, at Europe and other countries? First, they want the votes of the Greek immigrants, which is very funny because they don't like immigrants. They also try to legitimize themselves by opening offices all over the world. So if this cities accept them, they come back to Greece and they say, okay, we are not a Nazis party, because in all over the world they accept us. And last, and I think the more important, it's they believe that they will inspire the neo-Nazist fascist parties at all the world. But for us, freedom is unquestionable. So there are some things that we have to do. First of all, we must support and promote the dialogue with all our powers against the conservatives of the society, with open talks, activism, festivals, open assemblies in school, public spaces, working spaces, social spaces, etc. Secondly, we must continue and make stronger all the structures that had been instituted in the base of equality, solidarity, by the society and the movement, such as the occupied collective factory of Biomet. Thanas will say some things about this factory. The solidary social kitchens, the social clinics, the social spaces, etc. Don't mention them again. Third, we have to defend physically the free spaces and all the places that the individual can freely be expressed. We must protect those who are in danger by the Golden Dawn's battalions of Azad, with our natural president, of course, with anti-fascist patrols, but not let them to grow. We must not let them to take the public space, which they will use it against freedom. We must be with the society and not for the society. To this direction, the movement has created anti-fascist assemblies almost in every neighborhood in Athens and all over Greece. We have the anti-fascist patrols in the neighborhoods that the neo-Nazis try to appear. We have a big network that gain information about fascists, names, address, etc., etc. We do very often campaigns to inform people about Golden Dawn with posters, flyers, distribution, radio broadcast, etc. Wherever they show up, we try to be there and stop them one way or another. In this direction, we were informing you and asking you from you not to give them the legitimacy they want, not to give them the public space they want. To conclude, all people participating in the radical social movements must stand united against the neo-Nazis and the police who support them by all means, not only by turning a blind eye to them, but also with torturing, threatening, and sent to prison anti-fascists. Stand against them and win, because our passion for freedom is stronger. United we stand.
Rochester people, from me also. I would like to add some more things in what Vangelis said. So maybe you think that, or everybody who thinks that Greek people are not racist or they invented democracy or all this, that fascism is something surprising and something new. Actually, the conservatism, as Vangelis also mentioned, but nationalism also, that according to me paved the way to the fascism, is nothing new for the Greek society. Maybe it was disguised, but it was always lurking there. Since the establishment of the Greek state, due to the particular circumstances that took place at that period. Some people in Greece say that the message is the Enlightenment and the Renaissance ideas never arrived in Greece. Actually, before the Greek Revolution in 1821, there was a Greek Enlightening movement that was strongly influenced by the Western ideas, and these people praised not only the liberation from the Ottomans, but also the liberation from the ignorance and the superstition. However, and also because of that, the Orthodox Church that was powerful at those times was opposed to this movement. However, this movement was interrupted suddenly just after the revolution, and then never reborn again. And one of the reasons was that there was a competing romantic movement that gave focus mainly on the passion over the rational thinking. In that way, the Orthodox faith was established globally in the new Greek state, and it was enriched with nationalism. And this is how the Greek Christian notion Greeks have of about themselves was invented. And it became also the basis of the Greek constitution, and it was used excessively by the dictatorship and by the right wing. So the Greek state always try to arouse this constructed national consciousness by putting into action the two main ideological mechanisms, the school and the church. This is important because to the Orthodox Church, the enlightening ideas of people believing that they are bosses of themselves, they were never welcoming. Instead, they prefer to let people believe, keep people believe, that their lives were a matter of the God's will. That had two consequences for the Greek society. First of all, the rational thinking was never very much powerful. People instead were encouraged to believe in myths and metaphysics. In addition to this, people moved because they believed that they can't rule their lives. They moved from the public space to the private sphere, and they expected from God and later from gifted political leaders to manage their affairs, as it happens also nowadays. Also at school, in the history classes, are covered mainly two periods and almost nothing else. These periods are the ancient times, of course, and the Byzantium. Moreover, the history books contain information that it's more imagination, product of the of imagination, rather than accurate historical facts. For example, students are told that there were concealed schools because the Ottomans didn't allow the enslaved populations to learn Greek, and that the Orthodox Church was fond of the Greek Revolution. The truth is, though, the truth is that the Ottomans cared only about collecting taxes, and actually the Greek language was the language that it was used by during trading. But also, the Orthodox Church actually cursed the Greek Revolution because they didn't want to lose the privilege they used to have. Also, in this nationalist delirium, was cultivated also by the Greek literature courses, where they emphasized mostly on studying material that was reproducing stereotypes about the Greeks. So students were mainly taught to admire the ancients because they thought they shared the same DNA, and got the impression that the great civilizations were it was a matter of racial and biological superiority. And in that way, it was cultivated the intolerance, fanatism, and even imperialism. Because people thought also that they have a mission to fulfill, to spread the Greek culture and the democracy, and educate the barbarians, if this reminds you of something. So also, as I said before, the Greek constitution is full of abstract concepts that they are very good for politicians to use it in their speeches, and people accept them without reflecting on them, such as one of them is the good of the nation. So this had lasted for many decades. Even when the power passed from the right wing to the more progressive, let's say, political forces. Even the Greek communists, who were, as Vangelis mentioned, were the main leading force during the Second World War, have contributed to this nationalistic delirium. Even in the 80s, when came into the so-called socialistic party came into power and they remained there for almost 30 years, they never had the strength to change anything about this. For instance, they didn't separate the state from the church. Even today, for instance, there was a new taxation on the real estates, and only the church, the Greek Orthodox Church, was excluded from this taxation, and nobody else. And of course, I have to say that the Greek Church is owns a big property. Also, the school remained a bureaucratic, mainly mechanism, institution. That was teaching anachronistic material and cultivating that way the intolerance. And that, so, all these beliefs, they entered in each and every Greek house, and now that times are changing, they are standing just in front of us. So, I believe that if we want to fight fascism, we need to abolish once and forever all these ghosts from the past and stand on our knees and let ourselves out of this situation. Also, I would like to add that apart from the attacks to the immigrants, gay people, and anybody that does not comply with their standards, there is another major consequence of the rise of the Golden Dawn in Greece, is that permitted to the conservative racist voices to monopolize the public discourse. So these ideas that previously were marginal, now they have intruded in all aspects of the everyday life. The conversation has been moved to issues that previously were pretty much unquestionable. So, for example, some popular issues in the mainstream, but also in the social media, are whether the immigrants have the right to access the public services, schools, hospitals, whatever, whether the immigrants are a sanitary bomb, whether they are eligible after spending decades in Greece to get the Greek citizenship, whether the school history books are appropriate or contain information that can damage the Greek esteem, whether there is need for censorship committees to repress blasphemous blogs and theatrical plays, or even whether there is need of revising the law for restricting the demonstrations. And the orientation of the discourse towards this issue is that a parent association that has voted democratically, as they like to say, because they just raised their hands, against the Roma children being accepted to public schools. But even though worse than being continuously obliged to answer and bring down these strong beliefs is that the political agenda has moved towards this direction. So, for instance, the ex-government published the photos of sex workers who were HIV positive, and that was the reason they were arrested and published their photos. The reasoning was that they had to protect the people that they had sex with these workers, even though these people had paid more than paid them more in order not to use take protection, and of course their faces were never published. And that was the first time also that this happened to Greece. They published the photos of somebody.